Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Cody Brown. So this is my project, if you haven't already seen on your itinerary. The name of this project is the Anti-Slave Gantry Crane Controller. So the project background, I'm just going to go ahead and read this off. Vermont Tech has a few interactive educational devices for properly demonstrating control theory. Proper implementation of control theory allows robotics to achieve better stability, speed, and have greater safety when exposed to the public. And thirdly, advancements in modern electronics and manufacturing has enabled the fabrication of complex robotics that are difficult to control while with the common knowledge of control theory. So, in other words, as technology stands right now, we can build robots very easily that we can't actually control. And that just seems kind of backwards. So Vermont Tech would like something that would spike interest in this very specific area of engineering. So the problem statement is to design and fabricate a user-friendly gantry crane and controller that shows proper control theory as an educational instrument for Vermont Tech that allows for both automatic and manual control. Okay, so here, diving right into it, is my system diagram. And you can see before you that there are three main parts. And you can pretty much break any system into these three main parts. We're gonna start on the left, where we have our user interface, or human-machine interface, HMI. Here is where the user, or the human, asks the system to do what they want. And so in this case, you're going to toggle between automatic and manual control with the switch on the left. And then with the knob on the right, you're going to set a point at which you want the gantry crane to move to. The second part of this system is the state space system. So I'm going to go into that a little bit later. But basically, this system has an input and an output. Input, you basically say, go over there, and the system does something as a response. And then that response is visually or otherwise seen as your desired output. And so for this, if you don't already know what a gantry crane is, it's basically just a crane that moves along a slide. And so if, as you can imagine, it's rather difficult to control, as when you move the slide, it starts to swing. So this demonstration of control theory will hopefully be rather impressive and draw people to be interested in this area of engineering. And so here is the elephant in the room. The equations of motion for a gantry crane. And there's a countless number of ways that you can go about obtaining these equations. But if you were to ask me how to do it right now, I would lead you to use Lagrange's equation. Without going into it too much, Lagrange's equation is wonderful simply because it gets these equations through the use of simply modeling the energy that the system has, instead of having to look at the forces that are involved, like you would if you wanted to get these equations through, say, Newton's second law. So yeah, without going too much into it, you get these equations out in the boxes. So yeah, you can see that there are two equations. As this system is in fact holonomic, you get two equations because there are two degrees of freedom within the gantry crane. You have the X position where the cart is able to slide along the track, and then you have the angle where the pendulum is able to swing. Okay? And just so we can put our minds at ease, this isn't all just hocus pocus. We can actually look at these equations term by term and see if we can equate things that make sense to us. And so first off, on the first equation, comes from the generalized coordinate from Lagrange's equation for the x-coordinate. And so what we get on the first term is we get a term that looks an awful lot like f equals ma, or linear acceleration. And the second term, we get angular acceleration. And on the third term, we get centripetal acceleration. And so these are all things that we learn in basic physics, and seeing them in these motions, these equations of motion, is no surprise to us. On the second equation here, we see that if we make the acceleration of the cart equal to zero, so the cart doesn't move, this equation becomes the same equation for a pendulum, which is fairly intuitive. Sure, so we can be rest at ease that these equations, they're not as scary as they may appear. Okay, so now we have our state-space diagram. And I would advise you not to try to work this out like in your head just by looking at it, because you might pull something. But this is the diagram, and again, without going too far into it, I just want to emphasize a couple of things. So first, as you may have guessed, state-space modeling involves the use of states. And so on the top right, I have shown the four states that we have for this system. And these states include the two degrees of freedom that the system has, x and theta, but also the time derivatives of those two, which is the velocity of the cart and the angular velocity of the pendulum. Now, if you look at this dreaded block diagram, you see that it has this A and B matrix. The A matrix basically tells you how the states affect the states, right? So you move the slide back and forth, and that inherently causes a change in the angle, right? So this is all things that make sort of sense to us. The B matrix tells us how these states are affected by the input. So we apply a voltage on the motor, it causes it to turn, and that inherently moves the cart. This is all fairly intuitive. Okay, so this simulation that I made is indicative of how the work breakdown came to be for the gantry crane. It's very common in control systems that you are building the physical system in parallel with trying to design the controller. So in order to do that, we have to be able to test any controller that we make. And so how we're going to test it without having a physical gantry crane in front of us is to design a simulator. And so we designed this in MATLAB Simulink that will simulate the gantry crane, the full nonlinear system, using this block diagram. And it looks like a big, long rat's nest. And that's basically only because MATLAB Simulink, the blocks are very simple. So if you look at them, they're like, just like multiply these two things together and take the reciprocal of this, and these things take up like an entire square inch on your computer monitor, but they're really only doing very simple tasks. And together, they form your model for your gantry crane. Okay, so now that we have a simulator, now what we want to do is actually test a controller that we have. And so here is where we test the controller for a unit step response. And so we're going to simulate if the gantry crane was at one position at rest where nothing is changing, and we tell it to go 1 meter away from there, what does it do? What do these states do? And so this is just a graphical representation of that. In the blue, we can see that there's a cart's position, and then in the red, we can see the pendulum's angle. And it's just common nomenclature for control systems that we look at any overshoot and settling time. These are just names, very common names that we give things to help us feel smart. Okay, so moving on, so now we've got to design the gantry crane. One of the most important aspects is this actual cart. supporting the pendulum and as we're recording the angle. And so there's two main parts here. You can see that we have two holes. You can't really see them, but I pointed to them. And these are where the pendulum's cable, as a gantry crane, as any crane has a cable, where that cable is going to be fed through. And you can see this rotary sensor, or the rotary encoder, which is just a rotary sensor, senses the angle, is going to be mounted. Here you can see a little bit more detail, and there are two main things here that have to happen. The most important thing is that the axis for this rotary sensor has to be collinear with the axis of the pendulum to ensure accurate angle measurement. The second thing is indicative of the mechanical specifications for the slide that we purchased. And you see up on the top right that this torque or moment entitled MA is fairly low. It's 54 pound inches is the rated maximum value. And it's fairly large, but we want to ensure that we don't exceed it. So to do that, we want to ensure that our pendulum, that our load is placed directly under the rollers for the slide. And that way we get rid of any possible moment being generated in that direction. Okay, so going back, and so again, if you remember, I mentioned that we had four states. And however, our sensors only tell us what the current position of our 2 degrees of freedom are. And so to get the remaining two states, which I've circled here, which is the linear velocity and the angular velocity, to get these, we have to synthesize them from our position. So again, this may look complicated, it's really not. We have our x position, and we take the velocity from that by taking its derivative. However, if you just simply take the derivative of it, you take two position measurements and divide by the time that elapsed between them, you will get a very noisy output, because it's able to reiterate that value with every measurement that it gets, which is not desired at all. In physics, in a physics lab, in a physics lecture, this is how we were commonly taught to do it, which is fine with just simple mathematical problems. But in the real world, that's not acceptable. So what this guy does is simply creates a working average for that derivative. And so we can see the transfer function, the Z-transform, and finally the difference equation, where we can actually implement this into C code. And I've highlighted that function there. Okay, so now we look at the code development for the proportional feedback. And so this is the actual, this is the K matrix, if you care what it's called. But this is the proportional feedback. So here we are actually measuring those outputs, and we're synthesizing the velocity measurements from the previous slide, and we're taking those values, and we are giving some proportional feedback. We're multiplying it by some gain, and we're subtracting it from where we currently are to generate some error signal, and we're feeding that into the physical gantry crane. Okay, and so here's the work breakdown. As you may have guessed, the biggest thing was research state-space modeling. That went on for quite a while. And then we have a budget, and the total budget was fairly pricey. The most expensive thing was the linear rail. And yeah, any questions before we go over and see it in action? Yeah, so the sequence in building this, the first thing, once you wire up the motor, you just look at the proportional feedback. It's always a good idea just to throw a proportional controller at it first, just to make sure everything's working. So that's generally always where you start. Yeah. Yes?
Just out of curiosity, in your controls course, because you had mentioned MATLAB and Simulink.
Right.
Was MATLAB and Simulink introduced and taught a little bit in your controls class?
Yes, Simulink is used quite extensively. MATLAB, the actual code, we don't really use MATLAB too much, but Simulink we use pretty much every day for those courses. Yeah. Okay, so let's all go over and see.